director of the Center for Civic Innovation in Atlanta.
Good evening, everyone. How's everyone doing?
Great.
Great.
Good. I'm in a room filled with academics, and I'm the bad student that gets to sit on the side. So I'm very, very excited to be here. My name is Rohit Malhotra. I'm the founder and executive director for the Center for Civic Innovation. And I spend a lot of my time on the ground really talking to communities and dealing with the results and the consequence of fake news, and one of the ultimate consequences being a lack of trust. And what that's done inside of communities. And so I have a few points that I wanted to make. The first is that this is new. In a lot of ways, it's new. When I first started off my career, I actually was working for the One Campaign, which was Bono's big thing, and we were on the internet team. And it was a bunch of us that were under the age of 25 who knew how to use the internet. And so we had people coming in being like, hey, there's this dope thing gonna be called Twitter. You can follow people literally, like you can creepily just stalk the celebrity that you love, and you can get a sense of what their life is like. You should definitely try it. Could we do it with Bono, etc.? And that was the original intention in 2008 for these tools, was to connect us in a very different way that we hadn't been connected before. And so one of the first projects that we did, which was amazing, is we took all the email addresses of people who went to YouTube concerts. And as a hip hop fan, I wasn't as educated as I should have been on YouTube, but I didn't realize how many email addresses it would be. We literally, at the time, Google didn't have a function where you had a limit. We would BCC everybody, and we would send an email. We'd be like, hi, it's Bono. And I'd like you to actually speak out on this particular issue. Call your member of Congress. Here's a list of their phone numbers. And we shut down congressional lines. And you had our CEO came into the internet team's office and was like, what the hell did y'all do? Like, what were y'all doing? That's crazy. But that's awesome. Let's keep doing it. So we just kept doing it and doing it and doing it, right? And so you started to watch things like change.org and Move On and people using this petition-based service. Let's get people activated. This was new. It was a bunch of like people who just graduated from college figuring it out. And so when the president was elected, President Obama, he actually took a lot of our teammates and we became one of the first new media teams for the president. Now, that sounds glorious, but because there were not rules in place on how the president of the United States could actually communicate online, we were shoved into the basement of the DNC and told that we'd had to work there, but it's cool, there will be snacks, and you know how much we use my snacks. So we sat there, and we would think about how does the president of the United States, how should they communicate online? This was new. The president's about to win the Nobel Prize. What do we say? All of these absurd things that had never happened before. And as an organizer, what I would do is we would message some stuff online, then I would actually go on the ground and get to know some of the constituents that we're talking to. And I kid you not, I went to one training once where a woman came up to me and she said, sir, do you work with the president? I was like, yeah, I guess technically. That's what I tell my parents. And she said, I want you to deliver a message for me. She's like, I want you to tell Michelle that I really appreciated her email last night. I think that she was just so clear, and I love when she sends those messages to me, and every time I'm responding, she's not really responding back, but I get it, she's busy. And that sounds absurd to us right now, but that was not absurd in 2008, 2009, 2010. People actually thought the President of the United States and his wife, the First Lady of the United States, were communicating with them, and we used it as a tactic. We said we could get their attention. That, therefore, we could get them to donate, we could get them to engage, we could get them to show up, we can get them to say what we want them to say, how we want them to say it. And what we used digital technology was an opportunity to remove ourselves from the reason why we were able to do that in the first place. We removed ourselves from the ground. And digital technology will never be a replacement for human interaction. And we are learning that hard way. We're learning it in a way that is destructive. Because when we went back during the midterms, we had people come and say, where'd you go? We sent you an email. I don't check my email. Where'd you go? I thought the first black president would take care of me. Where'd you go? We forgot about the human side of our work. We forgot why this stuff matters in the first place. And so, what we also learned through that process is so many people didn't actually know how to use the internet. To this day, yesterday, I kid you not, my dad texted me for the first time, right? My dad texted me, and I replied with the Steve Harvey clap gif, where he's just clapping. My dad responded and said, "Why does he keep clapping?" And he was concerned about Steve Harvey. We forgot an entire group of people never were trained on how to use the internet. We figured it out ourselves because my immigrant parents sacrificed their own education to get me a computer to make sure I would never have to struggle, grow up with the ultimate privilege of growing up poor, not knowing I was poor. And you sit there and you realize we forgot so many people. And we're surprised that people don't, they're not gonna be able to differentiate between whether this is real or fake or whatnot because we forgot about them in the first place. We only give a shit about them when it's convenient for us. And so, I think we have to remember that media did lie. Look, I voted for President Obama, I worked for President Obama, and I may not like what everything that this president has to say, but the media lies. We have to accept that. The media portrays certain people in ways that is dangerous. The reason a kid was shot in a hoodie and was given that perception in the first place of being dangerous was not human nature, it was taught. The reason why when a person who looks like me is accused of a crime, we can call them a terrorist very quickly, but we can't do it if it looks like you. We gotta do the investigation first, we gotta be good journalists. That shit caught up. It caught up to y'all. And now you're dealing with the consequence of it. You pissed off enough people. You misportrayed enough people. Why? Because we thought data and technology was enough. But it's not. Because people are not data points. People are wrapped up in cultures and technology and feelings and traditions. My parents, who almost lost their house, were not a data point. But the media could have warned us about a housing crisis that was going to happen, but instead, after you watched headline news, you had another guy going and say, buy this stock, do this thing. My parents used to watch CNN religiously because they knew Susie Orman would come on and tell them exactly what they should do with their money. You deceived us. You told us it was okay to listen to Donald Trump when he was giving us real estate advice. Then when the housing crisis happened, you said, well, markets happen. But now we have to rebuild and repair. And we're constantly being told what we should do. So that's why we don't trust media. And so, when we talk about this stuff, we have to make sure we don't just treat people like they're crazy. They're not. They're hurt. We went through one of the greatest financial recessions ever. There's a reason why people voted for Brexit. There's a reason why people go out and behave and say the things that they say. They're hurt. And we never repaired that. Instead, we're trying to put another story to cover up the story. We've taken empathy out of this work. And we gotta bring it back. We can't just tell stories of amazing things happening on the ground in between at 2 a.m. with a segment that's sponsored by Colgate saying, no worries, look at all these amazing heroes that are going on. Tell the stories of the heroes as a part of the story that's happening every day because actually amazing things are happening on the ground each and every day. I get to see it. I get to watch ATLians who care about the city so deeply. The city that is the most unequal city in the entire United States still fight to make it better. Every day. I don't know whether they're Democrats or Republicans. I know that they give a damn about their city, and I know that they want to make it better. And I know that they are not relying on the media today, especially at a local level. We are not relying on you to tell us what's actually happening. Because local media is one of our greatest losses. Because national media will continue to play to whoever's going to pay for the commercials in between. Local media is by a lot of people who are reporting on what's happening right next door to them, or where they grew up, or how things are going on a day-to-day basis. And in cities, we have threatened local media so hard that we have said, if you talk out of line, we will make sure you never get coverage again. This president is not the first person to do that. We have mayors across this city, across this country. Freudian slip. We have mayors across this country who silence our media and say, if you talk bad about me, you watch what I do. To the point where when an agenda for an economic development authority gets flipped overnight, no one even knows, not even the reporters. So what's happening? We have to bring empathy back to this work. We have to empower our local journalists. And we have to take our failure vows, because this has been an imperfect journey and it's new for us. And unless we define it, it will define us. And I think we're in a lot of trouble in that way. But I'm optimistic, because if you take your eyes off of the screen, people are still amazing. And they are still doing the work. And this work will continue to go on with or without the media. The question is do you want to be a partner? Or be treated as the outsider. I hope it will be the former. Thank you. How many journalists are in this room?
Well, so there were several, but they have slipped out.
I would just challenge journalists to start having these conversations with communities. This has become an academic exercise, but I kind of feel sometimes we are in a room of taxi drivers when Uber's outside, right? And then there's I think that we're not in a position right now to, like, the academic debate around this is awesome, but there are people's lives that are being affected by this stuff on the ground. We can get back to the nuances of journalism at the national level and all of that, but I'm really concerned that information is being withheld from people in a real way, and I'm concerned that the people who are in charge of changing that aren't fully seeing what the root of the problem is. It's not that they don't trust you because your subject predicate whatnot is not in order.
Yes.
They don't trust you because you're still lying. Like, I think that you have to stop. We have to stop lying to people. I also think that newsrooms need to start looking like the people that they're reporting about. And when you look at actually who works in media and how you can actually get into working in media, if you don't sound white, if you don't look white, you're not going to be able to move up the ranks without a lot of pressure, or if you create your own publication. There has been a huge discriminatory practice within this field. We don't recognize it as an industry. So I think if you really want to get to the heart of it, it's messy, ugly, human garbage. Like, it's just really bad stuff that has piled up. This is a shift in power. Data is power. And when you were talking about Thomas Jefferson, and when you talk about Walter Cronkite, the one thing they had was power. They had the power to deliver the information when I wanted to give it to you, how I want to give it to you, and how much of it I want to give to you. Today, now the power has shifted back to people, and your reports and your data and the polls that you're doing, we don't feel it reflects us. Maybe it does, and we're making that connection because we're not smart enough or whatever that might be. But truth is, a lot of what's being reported on doesn't feel and look like us. And I'm concerned that the approach that we're still taking is just, you know, lipstick on a pig. And I really hope that we can start to change the way newsrooms look, so that we can also report on people's lives as they actually are, as opposed to how we see them. We become voyeurs and I think that that's something that I hope will change. And I think if there's a young kid that wants to, of color, that wants to be a journalist, we need to make that pathway a lot easier for them to get there so that they can be in the newsroom helping you fact check.